Stuart, here's what really fascinates me about the study of consciousness, that you look at all these smart people, scientists, philosophers, and they can't even agree where the level of hierarchy, the key area of consciousness, takes place. It starts at the lowest level of the fundamental space-time of the universe, which you might prescribe, and it goes up to the neuron, the synapse, the brain circuits, the entire brain, and then some would have it outside the brain in some non-physical way. I mean, the orders of magnitude are staggering. Why is that the case?
You put your finger on the issue. I think consciousness is scale invariant like a fractal. It can move through all these scales like music. You know, there's high frequency, there's low, like changing octaves in a musical score. And I think consciousness occurs at different scales at the same time or at different times at different scales. So, for example, when we're enlightened or in an enhanced state of consciousness, I think consciousness actually goes to a deeper level, goes smaller, faster, more intense, inside the neuron, for example, into the quantum level where you get non-local. When you get non-locality in the quantum world, then you reach out to everywhere. So then you have, in principle, the whole universe and non-locality and interaction between people, consciousness outside the brain.
So you believe that's a real possibility?
Definitely. Yes, I think it's a possibility. I can't prove it, but I think there's enough evidence for end-of-life brain activity, these near-death and out-of-body experiences and so forth. We can't rule out consciousness out of the brain until we have a true understanding of consciousness in the brain. I think consciousness in the brain is a quantum effect that is connected to the fine scale structure of the universe at the Planck scale, which is non-local, which means it's everywhere. So, for example,
do you realize what a radical claim that is? You're saying it like it's like you're describing something normal in the world. I mean, that is the most radical claim that I've heard, and some people, myself included, might think it's absurd.
As I said, until we can explain consciousness in the brain, we can't rule out consciousness as a quantum non-local effect out of the brain. And I don't take that lightly. I take it from, I don't make that statement lightly. I take it from evidence for near-death out-of-body experiences, some circumstantial evidences for afterlife. I don't claim that that's true. I just say it's conceivable, it's plausible that consciousness could exist in the fine scale structure of Planck scale geometry, which is everywhere. This could account for parapsychology, backward time effects that we see in Libet and in experiments of backward time effects, non-locality of various...
Throwing out a lot of terms that sound like they're very normal scientific terms, but they are extremely peripheral in terms of traditional science.
If consciousness is truly a quantum effect, as Penrose and I believe, it opens a Pandora's box for mainstream classical science.
All right, so let's get into that, because this is important, because most people would agree with you that there's this fractal effect, that consciousness exists at every level, but the vast majority, certainly of neuroscientists who I know and from the field that I'm from, would stop at a level of perhaps the synapse, that maybe it exists in some brain, total brain function.
But they would have to explain the paramecium.
They have to explain a lot of things, but let's just say where they are now.
Okay.
That they are whole brain circuits. Individuals said that it stops at the center. They said anything below that, there's no information. It's just the normal structure of the world. Just like there's a structure in this table, there has to be a structure in the neuron. There has to be quantum mechanical base, because everything is quantum mechanical base. But you're trying to sound scientific by using quantum mechanics when it's impossible to go below. Now that's the claim. And you have to, the burden's on you to explain why you believe what you believe.
I'm more scientific than they are. They can't explain a paramecium, which is a single cell organism that doesn't have any synapses. So if consciousness is an emergent property of synaptic interactions, then how do you explain a single cell organism? How do they explain memory? Because the synaptic plasticity, which is where memory is thought to be in conventional mainstream approaches, the synaptic proteins last hours to days, and yet memories can last lifetimes. It looks like memory is stored in the microtubules, in the cytoskeleton, inside neurons. So we have memory there. We have the paramecium. We have the fact that conventional approaches completely fail in explaining consciousness. They either get rid of it or say it's epiphenomenal or just blow it off entirely.
I will totally agree with you on that.
Okay.
That I think everything I've heard, and I think I know pretty much how the whole systems work. I think it all fails. I don't have any one.
Okay. Ours doesn't fail.
So you have to convince me of that. I'm less convinced of yours than I might be of others, but nothing has won my vote so far.
Okay.
So pitch me.
So each neuron has about 10 to the 9th subunits of microtubules. They can switch at about 10 megahertz.
That's about a billion.
It's a billion, and they can switch at about 10 million per second, which gives you 10 to the 16th operations per second per neuron.
Now, potentially.
Mainstream approaches to the brain say 100 billion neurons switching at about 1,000 synapses, 100 times a second, gives you about 10 to the 16th operations per second for the whole brain. So what we're saying is the capacity of each neuron is equivalent to what they're saying the brain is. Now, that per se doesn't buy you anything, because that's just more computation. That's just more reductionism. And in fact, that's where I was in about 1990, talking about microtubules as information processing for 20 years, going around saying, you guys need to go down inside to the microtubule level for all this capacity. And somebody said, well, how would that explain consciousness? How would that explain love, joy, fear, pain, what's now known as the heart problem? And I had to admit, I didn't know. It was a very good question. I was kind of stymied. I took a long figurative look at myself in the mirror and said, I'm a reductionist. Consciousness has slipped away. Fortunately, that same person suggested I read Roger Penrose's book, The Emperor's New Mind, which was a lot of things. It was a slap in the face to AI. It was a resolution of the measurement problem. It was kind of a merger of general relativity and quantum mechanics. But he had a proposed mechanism for consciousness based on a particular type of quantum state collapse, a type of quantum computing in the brain. And he argued that this connected the brain activities to the fundamental level of the universe where consciousness and platonic values could be embedded. I was pretty much blown away by that book. I didn't grok at all. I didn't really understand everything, but I intuitively felt right. And in the end, it was audacious and bold, and he had a mechanism which is still today the only proposed mechanism for consciousness that's ever been put forth, a type of collapse of the wave function. But he didn't have a structure in the brain to be a quantum computer. I had a structure that I had been studying for 20 years, microtubules, which could be quantum. And in fact, anesthetics act by quantum level effects to take away consciousness. So the quantum thing appealed to me. So he had a structure, he had a mechanism, not a structure. I had a structure, not a mechanism. We teamed up and developed our theory in the early 90s, which was attacked immediately by the mainstream neuroscientists for all kinds of reasons. But 20 years later, it's been 20 years at this point since our theory came out. The evidence is accruing on our side. We now know that from the work of Anirban Bandyopadhyay in Japan, that microtubules have quantum resonances at warm temperature. We know that plants photosynthesis use quantum coherence at warm temperature. Quantum coherence in biology is everywhere. Why, if a tomato or rutabaga can figure out how to use quantum coherence, wouldn't our brains be able to do so?
Well, look, I think this is an issue that's an open issue, but most traditional people think that the quantum effects are effects in everything. They're underlying all matter in everything that happens.
Well, the question and is, so the question what, is at what level
the question is, where is, why is that more important in the brain than it is in this table or in the grass?
Because microtubules are designed to have macroscopic, or at least mesoscopic, quantum states. Because the individual tubulins have a quantum channel of aromatic amino acids, where we now know anesthetics act to erase consciousness, that hook up with the neighbor tubulins throughout a helical pathway in the microtubule, so you get a quantum channel that goes the length of a microtubule, which in axons could be a meter. In dendrites, they're short and interrupted. But at least you have mesoscopic quantum states that can last, according to Anirban's results, at least a 10,000th of a second, which is long enough for what we need.
I think it's an interesting argument, and I think it's an important argument. I can't adjudicate it. I know most people don't agree with it, but that doesn't mean it's right, because nobody has a real solution. I have a different question. I would say, suppose you're right. Suppose that the quantum effect is working, and everything you say, all the crazy things you say, are absolutely right. It still looks like identity theory. And identity theory says that it's the same thing. It's the same guys who talk about identity theory in the brain, where you have circuitry is the green color of your shirt. It's not, I mean, it's the same thing. It's like calling Venus the morning star and the evening star. It's the same thing. And that just seems inconceivable that this experience of your green shirt is the same thing as this microtubule games that you're playing.
It has to be something, Robert. And the qualia, the greenness, we attribute to properties at the fundamental level of the universe, at the Planck scale, space-time geometry, where they are irreducible components. The same level that gives us mass, spin, charge, other mysteries. How do we explain spin? How do we explain the charge of an electron? How do we explain mass? It's curvature in space-time geometry.
So is your argument that consciousness is so strange and so fundamental to the world that you have to go down to the lowest level of the fundamental, irreducible building blocks of the universe, like spin and charge and the most fundamental things.
Not because it's so strange, just because that's where the logic leads you. I mean, as Roger once said, when you eliminate the impossible, whatever's left must be correct, no matter how seemingly improbable. Actually, Sherlock Holmes said it, and he quoted him. So it's not crazy. It's not. It's just that's where the path has led. And we have a theory that works. Evidence backs us up. Anesthesia is now shown to work on microtubules. Onorbon's results show that microtubules are quantum resonant structures at warm temperature. We have evidence on our side. These other guys are hand waving about complexity, and it doesn't really make any sense what they're saying.
Others would say that everyone's right when they say that everyone else is wrong. So you're right that Christoph is wrong, and Christoph's right that you're wrong. And what you really need to do is you need to go outside the physical world. You need to go to a non-material explanation, or you will never explain consciousness.
Well, outside the physical world doesn't mean immaterial. I'm a physicalist, but not a materialist. Christoph would say that consciousness is a property of matter. I would say that matter is a property of quantum collapse. You have quantum collapse that gives matter in a particular state. Constantly that's happening in our world. So I go below the level of matter to quantum and say that consciousness happens in the collapse within the microtubules that choose a particular state of the matter of the tubulin subunits.
Yeah, so, but you're still saying that something is happening there. As a physicalist, that is the experience of green. That is it. It's not what causes it. What is it? And that's identity theory. And some people just say, that's on its surface absurd. And therefore, you have to go outside the physicalist world. You have to go to something non-physical, not just non-material, but non-physical.
So now you're talking like Deepak.
I'm talking like me. Okay. Nobody controls what I say.
So Deepak Chopra and I have had this discussion. He comes from Vedanta. He said consciousness is outside space and time. And I disagree with that. There's no reason to do that. Everything he needs for the magic of magic and mystical nature of Vedanta and spirituality can be gotten at the level of Planck scale geometry, non-locality, and Platonic values embedded in fundamental reality.
Yeah, this is not about giving people what they want to serve their own interests, because that's irrelevant. It's what do you need to explain it? That's all I care about.
I'm with you. Closer to truth.